Next speaker is Professor Parth Chauhan. Pull up my notes here. And Parth is an assistant professor in the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research in Punjab. He's a Paleolithic archaeologist and is currently carrying out research in central and northern India on early human dispersals and ecological adaptations. His main specialization is looking at stone tool technology and its regional variations and change at landscape and individual site levels. In the past, he has been a postdoctoral fellow at the Stone Age Institute and at Indiana University, and a Fulbright scholar. He has his doctorate from University of Sheffield, his MA from Deccan College in India, and a BA from Rutgers. Please join me in welcoming.
Thank you, Ron. Just like to thank Professor Perry and Professor Larry for the invitation, and thank you all for coming. Basically, I have about 2.5 million years to cover, so I'll just get right to it, and I'll try to do it as fast as I can. So my topic is basically looking at Indian prehistory and Asian prehistory, and looking at key issues in regards to origins, intellect, innovation, and identity, especially identity. What we're looking for in the archaeological record, how we're trying to reconcile it with the modern hunter-gatherers, and trying to link it with surrounding regions. So just looking at a broad perspective, a review of the current evidence, the oldest paleontological evidence currently is in Africa, but we have several dispersals happening from roughly 2 million years onwards. And each of these dispersals is associated with different human species or hominid species and different technologies, ranging from Oldowan at 1.8 million up to Microlithic at 50,000. And this is based on genetic evidence, archaeological evidence, and some sites which have preserved fossil hominid evidence. So the challenge is basically trying to identify the number of dispersals based on the archaeology and the fossils, and also looking at genetic studies of modern tribals, as we call them in India, the hunter-gatherers and foragers. The problem with this, or limitation, is that it'll tell us the history of modern populations, but not the extinct ones, or the biological dead ends. And also our knowledge of the degrees and frequencies of these confrontations and interbreeding between modern humans and archaics during these dispersals is also very limited. And there's also problems with associating hominid species with different stone tool industries. And finally, there's different dichotomies between South Asian scholars, particularly Indian scholars, and Western scholars in terms of how to interpret the evidence, but also how to go about excavating sites, viewing the evidence, and comparing it with surrounding regions. So if you look at the Asian discoveries, and what are the implications? We have a growing number of fossils that are actually younger than 50,000 and showing different species than we previously thought, and more species than known in Europe or Africa. So basically showing a different and more complex evolution trajectory than previously known. So we're trying to understand how these related to different dispersals and mixing sometimes, as well as population replacements. And also, some sites are getting older because of redating, re-excavations, such as Lantian, for example. Earlier, it was thought to be 1.1 million, and now it's 1.6 million, at least. So showing an older dispersal of Oldowan technology than previously thought. And then we have possibly the earlier dispersal of modern humans. And this is, again, based on fossil evidence, for example, Fuyan Cave, and then also some evidence in the Middle East. And showing basically that there was not only an early dispersal, but the genetic evidence from the Neanderthals is showing that there was an earlier mixture or interbreeding between them. So, and then we come to the Movius line, which was actually dubbed by Holland Movius at Harvard in the 1940s, and this was based on distribution of Acheulean technology with hand axes and cleavers in the western side of that line. So for a long time, nothing was found on the eastern side, so there was a big dichotomy of in terms of cognition, understanding of technology, advancement, biological dispersals, technological dispersals. But gradually, hand axes and cleavers now are starting to be found east of the line. So what does that mean? What implication does it have? One thing is that the question being asked now is different. Earlier was that, why don't we have these technologies? But now, the question is different. The question is whether these technologies represent cultural transmission of the Acheulean, or to represent independent innovations of this technology. So this is a very critical question that is being argued and debated, especially comparisons of these assemblages with the classic Acheulean. And then we have significance of Indian prehistory. And just to sum up, basically Indian Acheulean is known since 1800s, okay, historically. And there's also been a historical need for identifying Oldowan assemblages. So the first dispersal, Oldowan dispersal, the reason is because of the geographic position of India or South Asia, trying to link up the dispersals from East Africa to Java, because we have 1.8 million year old fossils in Java and also similar fossils in Georgia, but was India a route? So it's not really clear. And there's also a historical need for identifying Upper Paleolithic evidence. And this is, again, based on European impact in the 1920s and 30s and 40s. And basically to identify or confirm the presence of modern humans. And also, how much of a contribution did India make to other regions? Not just in terms of technology, but also in terms of biology, genetic gene flow, and also if there were fauna migrations going from India to Southeast Asia, for example. And also looking at reverse migrations from Southeast Asia into India, so looking at multiple entry points into the subcontinent. And then also, basically, the questions we're asking, the controversies, the research trends are also changing. And I'll just outline some of those quickly. So right now, the biggest discoveries we have, oldest Acheulean outside of Africa, 1.5 million. We have possibly an earlier presence of modern humans, maybe before the eruption of the Toba volcano at 74,000. And the oldest microliths in India at 48,000. So they have different significances in terms of different dispersals and species arriving into India. The latest discovery, and very controversial, is possibly 2.6 million year old cut marks from the Shivaliks. And this is just reported about a month ago. However, there's a lot of problems with this in terms of interpretations, methodology, and some ethical aspects. So the methodology, first of all, the context is a problem. Everything comes from a surface context, not excavated context. Some of the artifacts, young artifacts appear to be mixed with older fossils. So these themes are recurrent in previous reports as well, especially in Shivaliks and central India. And there's also methodological limitations, which I won't get into for now, but I'll discuss later on. So look at the current controversies is identifying Oldowan assemblages. Although a dozen sites have been reported in the past, none of them stand, they don't match the criteria found in Europe, in China, in Africa. And there's a lot of claims of different hominid fossils from Shivaliks, from central India, from southern India, but none of them are valid. So far, we only have one human fossil, which is pre-modern. But again, the taxonomic identity is not, there's no consensus on that. And finally, we still have basically trying to link up Shivapithecus, Ramapithecus, which are ape fossils discovered in the 1800s and the 1900s. And earlier they were thought to be human ancestors, but now they're known to be ancestral to orangutan populations, okay? But they're still linked, and still used by some scholars in India to see if there's a continuity between these populations and the later hominins. Then again, as I said, the taxonomic debate over the Nirmada specimen, which is about middle Pleistocene or upper Pleistocene in age, but unclear about its identity. And also some postcranial fossils, especially shoulder bones, rib bones, have been used to identify two different populations in South Asia. One a normal-sized population and one a pygmy-sized population. And this is, again, controversial. And finally, the impact of the Toba volcanic eruption, as I outlined earlier, 74,000 years ago, on Indian populations, and also the ecology. And also the identification of tephra or ash belonging to an older eruption. So there's, because it's associated with Acheulean assemblages. So it's, again, a circular argument has been used to date the tephra and the Acheulean with mutual association. And then we have linking Middle Paleolithic stone tools with modern humans. The problem with that is that after 100,000 years ago, we have a lot of different technologies existing, especially 45,000 years ago. We have Middle Paleolithic, we have Upper Paleolithic, and we have Microlithic. So which species made which tools is not clear. And it's not always reliable to link specific technology with a specific species, as we know from the Neanderthal and modern human debate. So what are the controversies or issues related to modern human evolution in India? We don't know the timings and numbers of dispersals, whether it's they're coming in first time with Middle Paleolithic, or whether they're coming in first time with Microlithic, or multiple dispersals with different technologies. the genetic fossil archaeological evidence doesn't match. There's different timings. There's also a genetic and archaeological disconnect between the Indian evidence and the Australian evidence. A southern dispersal route has been hypothesized from South Africa along the coast all the way to Southeast Asia, but again, it's not matching. Technologies are different, the genetics is different, and there's alleged innovation, a report of innovation of microliths in India at 40,000 years ago based on environmental deterioration. But now we have older microliths of 48,000, so that kind of doesn't hold true. And also important, we're trying to explain the lack or low profile of symbolic behavior compared to Europe and other regions. Why is there so less compared to other places? Symbolic behavior such as paintings, engravings, ornamentation, and other types of complex behavior not associated with the older modern human populations. So is it a late arrival, or was something innovated independently in India? So these are the questions we're trying to answer. One of the problems is lack of dates for the rock art. And also whether humans were responsible for extinction of large mammals and ostriches as well. So there's issues of identity and regionality. We cannot rule out multiple or parallel origins of some stone technologies. Not only the simple ones like Oldowan, but also complicated ones like Acheulean, as we now know from the Mobius line issue. It seems to be independent innovation going on east of the line. And we also have to look at cultural transmission versus cultural influence and impact, looking at population levels, especially on the fringes and not in the core regions. And also we need to identify regional evidences. We basically ask, when does a dispersal or technology cease being African? If it's existing in the Levant or India for several generations, ultimately we have to give it a regional name, even if it's similar with African evidence. So because these technologies have changed, even in some small degrees or large degrees, we need to identify specific regional boundaries of these assemblages. And then looking at, finally, prehistoric identity of modern populations. How does it have an impact on how we view, how we treat modern populations, especially tribal groups? So we have the identity and evolutionary origins based on genetic studies, but there's a lot of gaps, and we don't really know exactly their origins, because a lot of these tribes have not been sampled properly. There's some continuity in the archaeology, such as 15,000-year-old shrine, and that matches up with modern shrines being built by the tribals. And the genetic studies have been used to pinpoint the antiquity, but not exactly match up the evidence with the archaeology, such as the microlithic evidence or paleolithic. And in Asia, in general, there's different portrayals of regional continuity, not just population replacement. Because of certain anatomical features, archaeology, and other aspects, there's reconstructions linking ancient populations with modern populations, and also same issue with not just in China, but in Southeast Asia with Homo floresiensis. A lot of the Indonesian archaeologists think that they're ancestral to modern Indonesians, but it's not agreed upon by Western scholars. And finally, one issue that I would like to highlight is who owns the Indian past, especially in terms of collaboration between Western and Indian archaeologists and paleanthropologists. There's some now imbalance in terms of how things are interpreted, how things are viewed, how data is accessed. Sometimes data is hyped, or interpretations or implications of the study are hyped for funding purposes, for publications. And also, finally, who makes the decisions? Who's bringing in the funding? What about author sequence? So these things need to be looked at, because all projects happening in India are not always balanced, although some are, depending on who's involved. So thank you. I'll just stop there.